Rice University. It's like the Tipton Hotel for 20-year-olds. It's general physics too. Today, more geometrical optics and vision correction. Dr. Stenson. Also, a defect in your eye. And now, a man who has given up on bananas because he's tired of all of their drama. Professor Hefner.
So much applause so early. You guys got to get your timing down. Did you see that transition? All right, here we go. People showing up. 31, 32, 33. My minimum audience is 50, so 33, 34. I don't just speak to crowd. 35. All right, so the two things to talk about. One is, I'd like more people to be able to watch it later. So one is the exam is tomorrow night through Monday night. Somebody asked me if they could take it earlier on Friday, but I can't find the message. I don't know if it's in my email or somebody texted it to me or somebody direct group meet it to me or somebody Canvas messaged it to me, or they Twitter messaged it to me, or they Facebook messaged it to me. I can't find messages anymore. But they asked if they could take it early, and the answer is unfortunately no, because it probably won't be ready. It's always ready at the last minute, and we are giving you like 3 days to take it now, so we can't really broaden it more than that. 809 doesn't have 0 point value. Yes, I will eventually set. We stop right now. No. I will change 8.0 down to zero. I hit it to zero and I probably didn't hit save. You gotta hit zero, hit update, hit save, log out. You gotta do it. I probably just messed up. It will be zero. Thank you for the transition. Okay, so about this exam. Okay, so it's a multiple choice exam. A, C, D, B, A, F. Those are your grades, not the answers. And we're giving you 3 days to do it. So I have to make it more secure than most exams. I don't want to like tempt you too much to ask somebody what their answers were. So I have added measures in Canvas so that if you cheat, we'll know and you'll get a really bad grade. Okay. So I described these measures to a colleague and he said, you know, if somebody gets caught cheating, they may claim entrapment. And I thought, wow, entrapment. I've heard a lot of wild shit. But I haven't had someone yet say, I cheated, and it's your fault. I would actually like this to happen to see if somebody would actually say that. So I decided what I'm doing is right now I'm telling you, don't cheat on the exam, okay? By giving you 3 days to take a multiple choice exam, I'm not saying do whatever it takes. This doesn't really matter. I'm not saying that. Do not cheat on this exam. If you do, I will nail your ass to the wall. I'm smarter than you. I've been on the internet and computers before you were born. Do not cheat. I'm not inviting you to cheat. You will not be able to claim entrapment. Was that clear enough? I can emphasize it harder. And I know anybody here watching this at 9:40 in the morning isn't the people. No, they're gonna cheat. Anybody that would cheat isn't gonna watch this video. Right? What do you mean by measures? Don't worry about it, all right? Don't look behind you while you're taking it, that's all I'm saying. Okay, so that was one thing to go over. It'll look exactly like a normal exam to you. I mean, it's gonna be normal. 25 questions, multiple choice, click, 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 that's all it is. All right, so don't worry about it. 25th is a joke, you get one free one. All right, oh my God, okay. So now, read the instructions. So no, you do not have 3 days to take the exam, I apologize. The window in which the exam is open, and this will be all the instructions, is 7 p.m. Friday. I'm sorry, 6, no, I haven't decided. 7 p.m. Friday to midnight Monday. But when you hit start, you'll only have 2 hours. So it's still a 2-hour exam. Close book, etc. Read the instructions before you take it. Another thing is we're making an open dictionary. Sometimes we use words and people say they don't know what they mean, like line or something. So you can look up words if you don't know what they mean. But it's not open book, it's not open notes. It's just like all the other exams, yeah. Yeah, so 2-hour time limit. All right. Other than that, yeah, it'll be just like all the other exams. Yeah. Hey, we hit 50, I'm willing to start now. The only other thing, yes, look at this. Current issue of The Economist. I didn't know I was such an influencer out there, so anyway. Okay, so what we're doing today is, we're still talking about geometrical optics. This is our little sort of quickie slipping geometrical optics in there. But enough that we'll be able to do a homework on it, and it'll be on the exam, and you'll like it, because this is, of all the things we do, this isn't the super hardest one. So we sort of defined, showed you the equations last time, did a bunch of examples, kind of do the same thing now, kind of explain as we go, and then we'll talk about how the eye works. All right? That's usually popular. So let's see. We were doing different cases of image formation by moving the object around relative to the lens. So maybe you recall we had a lens and it has this property called the focal length. So often when you draw, you have an optical axis, you draw your lens, and you draw the two places that are the focal length, and it's the same on both sides for the lenses we're dealing with. This is all the simplest case. And our object is this little line with an arrowhead on it. And we have two ways to figure out where the image is going to show up. We can do ray tracing, and we can use the equations. And what we've been doing is doing the equations and the ray tracing and showing they give the same answer. Okay, so we've done a bunch of different places, right? We did the object far from the lens. We did the object at the special place 2f away, or this distance is f, the focal length. When we left off in your notes, we had the object at the focus. And that made an interesting case that the rays came out parallel. Right? You know where the image is when the rays start to converge. And where they converge, that's where the image is. When we had the object way out here, we got images in here. But when we had the object right at the focus, we got two parallel rays coming out. If you look back, you'll see it's the one that went here straight through the focus, and then the one straight through the middle. Right? Those came out kind of parallel. Yeah, they come out parallel. And that, which means they never converge, you never get an image. And then the equation said the image distance is infinity, which is another way to say you never get an image. The rays go on forever, never get an image. So those kind of matched. Okay, I didn't want to redraw that because it's already in your notes once. But now what we're going to do is, what if we put the object inside the focus? What if we did that? So let's do our two methods here. Remember, there's the three easy rays. Okay, so one, easy ray number one was, we always do them from the tip of the object, straight to the object, and then through the focus. Because we know that's what lenses do. Parallel lines, parallel rays, parallel to the optical axis, go through the focus. And then the second one, this is an unfortunate place to write this. We're doing the three easy rays. The second one went just through the middle, like that. Right? See that right there? So you can already see something bad is happening here. These aren't even parallel now. They're diverging. Oh, God. And then the third easy ray, it's kind of hard to draw. Normally it's here, and you go through the focus, and you go straight. Can't do that now because the focus is behind. Okay, the way you do this one is you draw an imaginary line, a ray that would go from the focus to the top of the object, and then you continue it as a real ray, and I didn't make the lens tall enough, but that one would go straight. Okay. Now really, if you can't do that one or you can't remember that one, not that we're gonna have you drawing these on an exam, but if you can't do that one, you really only need two. All three of these will converge to the same place when you make an image. So really two is enough, but that is officially the third one. So you can see what's happening here is if we put the object inside the focus, we're not, the rays aren't converging to make an image anymore. So that's unfortunate. So we have diverging rays. Oops. All right, so what are we gonna do about it? Don't know, why don't we look at the equations and see what they say? Maybe that'll give us some insight. So remember, there's two equations in this whole, anything about thin lenses, we're doing it all with two equations. One over S, one over S prime, one over F. So what this means is 1 over the object distance. So there's S. 1 over the image distance, and which is from the lens to the image, but I don't know where the image is at this point. And 1 over F, that's the focal length. Okay. And the other one is the magnification. It is minus the image distance over the object distance. Okay. And to kind of check these, rather than doing numerical examples, I've been giving you object distances as a function of F. You know, if we want it to be twice as far as F, we were saying S equals 2F. If we want to be really far, we said A equals 10F. Right? So now we would say S is less than F. And I think what I wrote down is, let's say S is 3/4 F. That's a way to get it inside F. Okay, so S equals 3/4 F. So then we do a lot of these little fraction equations here. 1/3 F plus where is this image going to show up equals 1/F. And what we've been doing is using this to figure out where is the image going to show up. All right, so that looks good. So what we would do is then bring this over here. All right, so this is minus, bring that 4 to the top, 4/3 F, that's the minus sign, 4/3 F. And just to make the fractions work out, we can multiply this by 3/3 F. So we get minus 1/3 F. Okay, so then we get what? Flip it over, S prime is minus 3 F. So that is different from all the other ones we did. Before, this would always come out positive, because this side is positive object space, and this side is positive image space. Right? So we would always get an image over here, positive, converging lint rays. So when we have this diverging case, we have one, it doesn't look like anything's diverging over here, or I'm sorry, it doesn't look like anything is converging over here. And we get a value for the image, but it's negative. Okay, so it didn't make it like undefined, it is a number. And what about the magnification? So the magnification here would be minus 3F over 3/4 F. F's cancel, I believe that would be 4, positive 4. Now remember, for the cases where the object got here, the magnification always came out negative because these real images were always inverted. So now we got this case inside the focus, diverging rays, a negative object, a negative image distance, and a positive magnification. What could it mean? So what it means is we have made a virtual image. So this is very confusing. What is a virtual image? And so people often ask, what is a virtual image? So often you're just given a list of bullets. These are the properties of a virtual image. Let's talk about what it really is, though. So what is an image? So an image, we talked about before, is when you have like a point source on the object scattering all of its light, goes out into space, and the lens pulls it back together and focuses it to a point. Every point on the object has a point on this image. So the image is like a real space representation of the object. And if I took like a screen there, I can see it. Because then all those real space focuses are arranged just like the object, and then those go to my eye, and my eye sees them. Or you could say, this real space arrangement of focused light, I'm just going to stick my eye there, and it'll go in my retina, and I can put it on my retina and see it. Depends on what makes an image real to you, I guess. I'm getting into the metaphysics of it. But a virtual image, the difference is, these rays are not converging, right? They're diverging. So you would say, well, there's never an image. There's never a real image. But what if I put my eye here, right? Or something, or a robot puts their eye there, and these rays come into their eye? Well, what we're going to talk about soon is your eye does have lenses that forms real images on your retina. So your eye can still take these diverging rays and converge them onto your retina. Now your eye, even though it's very close to your brain, is dumb, okay? It doesn't know there's a lens there. So the eye is just going to say, I am receiving these rays, and I was told in a physics class that rays just go in straight lines, okay? So I'm gonna assume that one goes back like that. that one goes back like that, and that one goes back like that. Therefore, in my feeble eye brain, there must be an object, an image right there. Okay, so it interprets these as an image. So that is a virtual image, okay? It is the apparent image based on diverging rays. Because if you think about it, when you illuminate an object and send its rays to a lens, those are diverging rays, right, at every point, and they go out into space. So this is the same thing. These are diverging rays, okay? That's the idea. And we look, and what we'd find, if I'd have really drawn that at 3/4 better, this would exactly match the math. You can see. So if I'd have drawn that farther over here, it would have pushed it back to minus 3F, right? It would have been way up here. It just gets hard to draw, okay? So that's where the minus comes in. If you see a minus on your image position, that means it's on the same side, right? That's the normal positive image position, is on that side of the lens. It's showing up on the same side as the object, right? The wrong side, okay? So apparent, we have a negative image position, is another thing. And also look, the way it came out, it's upright. All those real images were inverted, but this came out positive. And sure enough, the virtual image is positive. So it's upright. I put non-inverted, but that might be a double negative, I'm not sure. Apparent, can't put in. And another thing is, well, this goes with apparent. No, you can't cast it onto a screen. You can cast it onto your retina and see it because the lens is in your retina. Take those rays and make a real image, but that's unrelated. You can't put a piece of paper here and cast it on the piece of paper. Okay. So we'll look for more virtual images as we move forward. But now with the converging lens, we've done it all. We had it way far away. You got a teeny image near the focus. As you brought it closer, did it go, let's see, it comes in. When you brought it at 2F, you got an equal size image. Okay. Way far away, we had a little image right here just past the focus. As you bring it in, that image grows. When you're at 2F, you get a magnification of 1. It's just the same size. And as you keep going, that image gets bigger and bigger and bigger towards infinity. And when you get the object at F, it's infinity. And then as you keep going, then suddenly it comes in as a virtual image. Right? So we've done sort of all those cases. You don't have to have that memorized, but that's kind of the behavior. Right? So that's kind of how the image behaves in this system. So that's what we're going to do with converging lenses. I mean, we'll play with them more for the eye in a second. But I actually have a sample problem. Like, you may be thinking, how are we possibly going to do problems in this? Let's see. Let me show you what you could now do, because you are now really good at geometrical optics. Here's an example. Where must an object sit? It's not very precise. To create a virtual image, twice the size of object with a converging lens. That's a question. So you could start trying to do it by ray tracing. You could do lots of drawings and put it in different places. And like, you might immediately say, oh, a virtual image twice the size, the object is probably going to be inside the focus. It's going to be less than F. Or you could go after it with the equations. There's only two equations here. 1 over S plus 1 over S prime, object distance, image distance, focus, and the magnification is the negative of the image distance over the object distance. So, like, you might write these down and figure out, now, what am I looking for? What's given? What am I looking for? Where must it sit? I'm looking for S prime. To calculate a virtual image twice the size of the object. Twice the size of the object. And it's positive because it's virtual. So you could just do that. and say, let's solve these equations, right? So we have sort of three unknowns here, although you're going to solve for S in terms of F. So F can just remain a constant. So really, the unknown is here, but we have two equations, right? So you could just say, oh, this must mean that S prime equals minus 2S, and then stick it there, right? Then you'd have, make sure this is the path I actually used. Yes, so you have 1 over S plus 1 over minus 2S, right, there in the denominator, equals 1 over F. We're trying to get S in terms of F. Right? And then algebraically, the quick thing to do would be to say this is times 2 over 2. So 2 over 2S to get the same denominator. You realize that's just minus 1. So you get 1 over 2S equals 1 over F. And you flip them over, and you get 2S equals F. So the position you'd have to put it is 1 half F. And that matches what we were talking about, right? So we're just saying, where are you going to put this thing? F. Good news is, it's saying put it halfway. And before, what we talked about was, when you're inside, you do get a virtual image, yada, yada, yada. All right, so that all makes sense. So you see, the problems will either be some ray tracing, like we'll set it up and you do the drawings, or you can just use these two equations to solve problems. You could also ask, where is the image? Right, we eliminated S prime, but now we can get it, right? Where is the image? 1 over S, so 1 over 1 half F is where the object needs to be. Plus 1 over S prime you're looking for, where is the image, equals 1 over F. So bring that over there, that's 2 over F, and minus 2 over F, right, 1 minus 2 minus 1 over F. So S prime actually ends up being negative F, 1 minus 2 is minus 1. So S prime is minus F, so you do get the other thing required for a virtual image. You get that the image ends up on the same side as the object. So it'd be right here. So it'd look like this. Oops, except it's virtual, so we usually dot it. But you can't see my dotted lines. We've solved so many problems technologically, except you can't see my dotted lines. All right, so that's an example of a problem. Isn't this stuff fun? So converging lenses create virtual images and diverging. Okay, so all we've done so far is converging lenses, and they create both real and virtual images. Depends on where the object is. All right, so all of our lenses have been converging. For all the places outside F, they created real images out here somewhere. As soon as you go inside F, they create virtual images. So they create both. We haven't done diverging lenses yet. They're coming in a second. All right. I think they're coming right now. Okay, so the next question is, perfect segue, can you give negative f's? Can f be negative? Never thought of it that way. And the answer is yes, and that's called a diverging lens. All right, so let's look at a diverging lens. I mean, you still use an optical axis. And, you know, if you want to draw it, it looks like that, right? It's, instead of it being convex, it's concave, okay? But we're not doing a lot of the work on the geometry of the actual lens itself. We're just going to talk about how they behave. Let's see. Does it have a focal length? Yes. In the same way, you draw an F there, and you draw an F there. So there's F and F. Yep. And we're going to do the same thing. We're going to do ray tracing and equations. So rather than do all those cases, we'll just do a couple of them. Right. So what if we put the object at 2F? Okay, so let's put object at 2F and do that case and see what we get. Let's do the ray tracing first. All right. So three easy rays. Three easy rays. Okay, it's physics. Easy. That's not my name, by the way. That's like famously what they're called. Number one. So number one is straight. And then from the focus, and I'll show you what we mean when we draw it. So straight, so far you're saying this is just like converging, it's very boring. But when I say, before it was to the focus, now you draw a line as though it came from the focus. Ah, that one's diverging. Why does it do that? Oh, it's the Snell's law applied at those two curved interfaces. This is why all this is happening. Easy ray number two is through the center. So that one is the same, because that one basically, the refractive effects are canceling out between each side. They cancel out for converging, they cancel out for diverging, because the two angles are kind of opposite. And then what is the third easy ray? Let's see if I can remember. Down the middle, towards the back F, and then straight. I forgot how this one works. Oh yeah, so you're drawing it as though you're drawing a line straight to there. That's not very good. You draw that line, and that ray, wow, that ray that's headed for the focus ends up going straight. Right. So you draw it solid on this side because it is a real ray, but then it bends straight. So there's your three easy rays. 2F straight. All right, so one, two, three. Okay. And now you want to know where's the image though, right? So they aren't converging. It's the same as before. You imagine them coming back. So this one coming back already has its dotted line. This one really comes back. So it's right there. And if we want to get the third one in there, what would someone looking at three say? They'd say it just goes straight back. And there it is. So I'm going to draw it solid so you can see it. There's a virtual image right there. How do I know it's virtual? It's on the same side. It's upright. These rays are actually diverging. You can't cast them on a screen. So when you asked about converging, diverging, as the rules, the converging lens could make real or virtual images, depending on where the object is. What we'll find is a diverging lens only makes virtual images, no matter where we put this. It'll never make a real image because it will never cause these rays to converge. Let's do the math. 1 over S plus 1 over S prime. It's the same equation, same magnification, same, right? You don't have to relearn the equations. The only thing, so you'd say, well, then how do you get a different result mathematically? The one way you do is diverging lens has a negative F value. So for all those converging lens problems, the F was like 30, so we put in 30. The F is 100, you put in 100. So now if it's diverging, you would put in negative 30 and negative 100, right? Which makes it a little awkward when we write the equations, but I'll show you, okay? So let's do this 2F problem mathematically. By that, I just mean we're putting the object at 2F. If this were a numerical problem, we'd say we're putting the object at 60. And the focus is negative 30. Okay, so here we go. 1 over 2f. But now when we say f, we mean the magnitude of f. Okay, so this is an f equals, say, 30 centimeter lens. I don't know, let's just make up a number. So when we say the object is at twice the focus, we don't mean we're going to call the object distance negative. This is still the positive object space. We're just saying it's twice actually the magnitude of the focus now. You know, the focus is negative, so we don't want to imply that it's on the other side or something. So that's why, just to be annoying, I'm going to put those bars on the F. around you. That's like the size of the focus. Where does the image show up? That's kind of what we're asking, I guess. See if it shows up right there. Equals 1 over n. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to write the minus sign in and write it as a magnitude there. Okay? I'm trying to remove the ambiguity that if I say, if I write that as just 1 over minus f, then it's like, well, did you put the minus sign in, or do I put the minus sign in because it's a diverging lens? Right? So the point is, if it's an f equals minus 30 centimeter lens, you put 1 over minus 30. Right? So I'm telling you, put minus and then the whatever the value is. But if it's 2f away, 60. Okay, so I'm using those bars to try to make it clear exactly what's happening here. Okay, so, well, we can bring that over there. I want to solve this real quick. We bring that over there, bloop, bloop. And this would be 1 over s prime equals minus 1 over 2f. Well, let's go ahead and then make this 2 over 2f. So minus 2 over 2f is that term, 2 over 2. Minus 1 over 2f. Okay, so you can see now they're going to combine to minus 3 over 2f. All right. And then you're going to get, let's see, 1 over s prime is minus 3 over 2f. So s prime is minus 2/3 f. So I run out of board. So I'll write it right here. Is minus 2/3 f, where f, again, is just the magnitude of the thing. Okay. S is, the image shows up at minus 2/3 f. What does that tell us? It's on the same side as the object, so it must be virtual. That's good. It's also inside the focus. Now look at that. It's at about 2/3. It matches the ray tracing pretty well. Okay. What about the magnification? Let me erase our little three easy rays description here. Same formula. The magnification is minus the image distance, which was minus 2/3 f over the object distance, which was 2 times f. Right? Yep, so 2 times f. So things that cancel, f, 2, those two cancel to make a positive, and we get a third. The only thing left is that third, a positive 1/3. So that's a sign of a virtual image, an upright image. It's one thing. And look at it, it even looks like it's about a third. Not bad. Not bad chalkboard ray tracing. No, I can't find it.
Danger's my middle name.
All right. We can do one more. Let's do one more. Let's do one more diverging, and then we'll think about the eye. Yes, okay. 40 minutes. Yeah. Yeah, one more diverging, and then we'll think about the eye. Just to make sure you can see physically. It'll never give you a real image. Because just there, we did a diverging case. Oh, no, we did it outside, yeah. So we did it at 2F. And you might think, is there ever a case where a diverging lens is going to give you a real image? So let's put it really far away. Object really far. We could do it really close, but those are really hard to draw. Now let's do it far away. Let's just do one really far away. We'll do it real fast. This is part one. There we go. So there's your object. There's your F. Like that. What if we put it really far away? It's hard to draw. Let's see. So you've always got your straight ray. It's as though it came from the focus. That's one. You've got the one straight through the middle. Oh, wow, they're supposed to go straight, though. And what's that really hard one? It's the one that, wow, that's bad. Let's see. It's the one that was trying to go straight to that F. But it got thwarted by the lens. Right, so there they are. So you can see far away, they still diverge. Where are they gonna meet? Right there. That one's there. This one looks like it came there. Look at that teeny little virtual image right there. Look at how cute it is. So we could say, okay, this case, still upright image on the left on the object side must be virtual. Diverging rays, everything. Let's say that the object S was 10F, really far away. 1 over S plus 1 over S prime equals 1 over F. Because it's diverging, so we gotta remember that we're gonna put a negative sign there. 1 over minus whatever that focus is. Right, yeah. So it's gonna be 1 over 10F plus 1 over S prime equals minus 1 over F. And then we bring this over here, minus 1 over 10F, 10 over 10F. I'm doing some fast algebra here. And that becomes minus 11 over 10F. Let's see, the negative, yeah, it stayed negative, is 1 over S prime. So you get that S prime is minus 10 elevenths F. S prime equals minus 10 elevenths, whatever the F focal length was. And yes, negative. 10 elevenths means almost on the focus. See, not quite 10 elevenths the way I drew it, but this also wasn't quite 10. Right. It always works. Can it ever be wrong? No. M equals minus S prime over S minus, what was S prime? That's the object distance. Minus 10 elevenths F. Oh, minus S prime over S, sorry. And what was the, I'm sorry, I'm gonna say, what was the image distance? Minus 10 elevenths F. What was the object distance? 10F. So what is the magnification? 1 over 11. Whoa. It looks like I didn't finish that part, but it's 1 over 11. Positive, very small, okay? So this gets boring after a while. I mean, it can't go wrong, it never goes wrong. Why does it work? What's the deal? Why is this two stupid formulas describe this geometry so accurately? That was embarrassing. It just does. So it's true for really thin lenses, low curvature, there's a bunch of geometric approximations, and this is just how it works. You make it a little more reality about it when we talk about the eye, okay? So we're gonna do, it's only 10:16. We're actually gonna take a break early because that'll leave us plenty of time to talk about how the eye works and how the optometrist is ripping you off. All right, the video for the break is about a defect in your eye. It's from an online class and it's like 2013, however long ago that was. And I guess I'll wait till it's over and then I'll tell you how you could do this at home if you want to find the defect. I watched the video, I don't think it really explains it, how to do it. So I'll tell you how to do it after the break. Okay, so it's 10:17 and a half. So I'll see you at 10:22 and a half. Hello, I have a 201X art project for you for the weekend. So a couple years ago, I was teaching 201 on campus, and after class, I had to go to a faculty meeting where the president was presenting some very important data. And I was carrying my large polarizer with me because I'd just gotten out of class. And I was sitting in the back of the meeting, and when I saw something I wanted to see, I held the polarizer this way, like this. And when I saw something I didn't want to see, I turned the polarizer like this. And that would make the screen go black when I didn't want to see the screen, because I'm basically not a very mature person. So, but when I was doing this, and I looked at the screen as I rotated the polarizer, I would see this little yellow shape right in the middle of the screen, and the little yellow shape would rotate with the polarizer. It's very strange. I thought, well, maybe it's just a defect in my polarizer. So I had multiple polarizers with me. So I checked another polarizer, saw the exact same shape. So I thought, well, maybe it's a defect in the LCD projector. Maybe there's some stress in the liquid crystals in the middle of the little liquid crystal panel, and that's what's causing it. So I went to another screen, just in my classroom, held up the polarizer and saw the exact same little yellow shape. So I thought, well, maybe this is a common defect in LCD projectors. So I went to another LCD projector, saw the same thing. I looked at LCD display, saw the same thing. And then I just looked at a white wall with a polarizer, and I noticed you can even see it just on a wall. So clearly, it's not the source, it's the detector. I realized that this is something going on in my eye.
thought, wow, I can see polarization, right? So human eye is not meant to, you can't detect polarization with your eye, but you actually can a little bit. There's this little defect in your eye that lets you kind of see some effects of polarization through this little yellow squiggle. I thought, well, maybe it's just my eye. I Googled around and found, no, this is a known phenomenon. It's called Haidinger's brush. So my assignment for you is to first see if you can see Haidinger's brush. Okay, so it's very dim. So you need to be looking at something that's evenly illuminated, like a white wall, or maybe the sky, if the sky is clear. And also to detect it, it helps if you can rotate the polarization. So you don't really want to look at a polarized source. You want to look at just a white or evenly illuminated unpolarized source and have a polarizer and rotate the polarizer when you look. And that way, when you see it turn, you'll be able to detect it better. And I want you to see Haidinger's brush, and then I want you to draw what it looks like to you in whatever drawing program you can get your hands on or with your hand. And I'll start a forum thread of everybody posting their Haidinger's brush, and we'll see, do they all look the same? Do they all look different? Do we all agree on what it looks like? So don't go look it up on Google first. You know, first get your own personal impression of what Haidinger's brush looks like, commit it to paper, and then we'll compare them. I don't think there's ever been a massive study of Haidinger's brush before. So let's see what it looks like.
All right, so that Haidinger's brush is I call it a defect in your eye because it has to do with the crystallinity of I think in the cornea or the lens. It's probably in the lens. And this is actually kind of interesting. It's when I tell you that glass has an index of 1.5, that's what causes the light to bend and the speed of light to drop, you know, and the wavelength to change. I'm implying that there's just a constant index of refraction for the glass. It's the same in all directions. If you think about the molecular structure of everything, of materials, and that light is vibrating the electrons, you might realize, should it be the same in all directions? And for glass, it should, because the molecular structure of glass is a random network of SiO2, just silicon's oxygen is random. So every direction is pretty much the same at a microscopic scale. But if you have light going through a crystal, weird stuff can happen. Okay, so you can get something called birefringence. So this is a piece of calcite. It's a natural piece, but it's pretty clear. You'll probably never guess where I got this piece of calcite. I've offered thousands of dollars before. No one can guess where I got it. But what happens is something very bizarre, which I didn't practice this ahead of time, but, oh, and I have the white, oh yeah, okay. So I have the exposure constant. You probably can't see, but if you look through a piece of calcite, Oh, you can't see that either. Yeah. Okay. Well, next time I'll turn the auto exposure on. And as you rotate, like if you look at something through calcite, you see two of them. Wow, two of them. And as you rotate it, the two things spin around each other. Right? So that's what's called the ordinary ray and the extraordinary ray, because it's extraordinary what's happening here. There's no way you'll see it. Not just me. Put it on myself here. If you can see my eye, that there's two of them. I think you just see white. Yeah, okay, never mind. So it's because the material is crystalline, and the proteins that make up your eye lens have some also amount of crystallinity to them, and they come to a point at the front, and that's where there's a little bit of anisotropy in the index. It's sensitive to polarization. So that's why it takes polarized light to see this. So if you want to see it, you don't have a big sheet of polarizer. I forget that most people don't have a giant polarizer sheet. But if you go get some polarized sunglasses and turn them like this and look at the blue sky, a nice even blue sky, and rotate it like that, you'll see this little yellow shape hourglass thing turning. And if you don't see it, keep looking for it. And if you really can't see it, you probably have an unusual lens of your eye. I've never met anyone yet who couldn't see it, so it'd be interesting if you can't see it. Hadron's brush. All right. Let me tell you, those were wild times in 2013. We were online classes and talking about Hadron's brush. I mean, did I get the calcite at the store? No. Amazon? No. Mordor? Close. You're getting close. That's actually the closest anyone has ever gotten to guessing where I got the calcite from. All right, so let's look at the eye. We're going to take those lens concepts and think about the eye a little bit. First of all, the eye is a ball. I'm watching Battlestar Galactica 2004 with my family. That's our current show. And Colonel Ty gets his eye knocked out. He's like, popped it out, looked like a deviled egg or something, or a hard-boiled egg, because it's really a big sphere, right? And this front thing is called the cornea, right? Back here is the retina. That's like the CCD camera, right? That's the image sensor that goes to your brain. On the back, the cornea is kind of like the lens. Here you've got this thing that adjusts the amount of light, the pupil. That's the thing that opens and closes, you know, to let in more or less light. It's always very wide. And then there actually the lens is in here, right? This is the lens, but really the lens and the cornea act like a lens together. You know, the front of your eye is curved, so clearly it's gonna do some refracting, but then the lens does some refracting as well. And the distance we're gonna standardize is we're gonna say it's 17 millimeters from the lens to the retina. Now, really, it's like two lenses, and it's complicated, but we're going to pretend this whole thing is just a single lens and your camera, your CCD camera here, and this is 17 millimeters. That's the physical structure of the eye we're going to use as we try to figure out what's going on. So to see, you need a real image on the retina created by the cornea lens. Right, those go together and act like a lens. All right, here we go. Let's see, so let's use this information. Basically, it's a lens 17 millimeters to the screen. And let's see what happens when you look at things. And let's see what can go wrong. All right, here we go. Let's look at something very far away. All right, so let's say you got your eyeball here, which I'll just draw as a lens, an optical axis, and then that's where the image has to be, right? So this distance is 17 millimeters, is S prime, we're saying it's got to be 17 millimeters because we got to have the image landing on the retina. Okay. The object might be some mountains you're looking at far away. Maybe it's Mordor. And we're going to say this is 1,000 meters. S. 1,000 meters to the mountains. They're a kilometer away. Yeah, you could see them. Yeah. So what we're going to do now is do our little formula and say, okay, what is the focal length of your eye in this case? 1/1,000 meters plus 1/17 millimeters equals 1/f of the eye. Okay. Now, if you look at that, you might realize this is a huge number, this is a teeny number. So when we invert it, the answer is basically going to be this 17 millimeters. All right, teeny number, huge number, so it's basically this number. And then we go re-invert it, and we get the focal length of the eye in this case is about 17 millimeters. So we're very close to 17 millimeters. Right, so it's about equal to S prime. This actually matches what we've been talking about. If the rays are coming from a mountain a kilometer away, they're essentially coming in parallel. And remember, parallel rays hitting a lens focus at the focal point. Okay, so for all intents and purposes, your focal length of your eye in this case is the same as that 17 millimeter distance. Okay, so this is K, so parallel rays. And this is why they say if you have eye strain, look at something far away, because this is when the eye is relaxed. Okay, as we do other things, we use muscles to change F. So muscles are not changing F. Okay. So we've all been staring at screens for a year. That's why your eyes, you have eye strain. So it's good. That's why you open a window, is you occasionally look out the window. Let your eyes relax. Okay. Okay, so for a normal eye, so let's wait that for the next one. Okay, so that's just a simple thing we could do. Look at something really far away. Well, let's see what we're saying next. Let me make sure. Yes. Okay, so now let's look at something closer and see what does the eye have to do about it. All right. Okay, when the object gets closer, what is going to happen? So here we go. What do we know? We know that you have a converging lens in your eye. We know that the image has to show up here where the retina is. So we know S prime has to be 17 millimeters if you're gonna see. All right, I'll even go ahead and just draw the image right there. It's gotta be there and it'll be inverted. All the little images of the world on your retina are inverted, believe it or not. So actually I'm not gonna draw it yet because it's not gonna land there. I'll have to fix it. So let's say the object is out here, and where would F be? Well, we just said when the eye's relaxed, the focal length is basically also 17. So we could say here and here is F and F. That's the relaxed eye, right? Okay, so this thing's out here, a little past 2F, something like that. And we would say, okay, where is it gonna end up? Three easy rays. Right, like that, and then one going through the middle, whoops, and I drew it too big, but you get the point. Okay, so when the object gets closer, the relaxed eye puts the image behind the retina. So it has to change, right? So the muscles in your eye have to bend the lens to reduce the focal length. Bend the lens to, and then you can think, do we need to reduce it or do we need to make it shorter focal length or longer focal length? We need a shorter one to contract the rays harder to get the image on your retina. So the muscles in eye bend lens to reduce the focal length. Something like that. We'll do the math here in a second. Okay. We aren't going to do the math because we would need a number here. I have an X here. So say if we just call this X, we can kind of show mathematically, I think is what I'm doing here, that we have 1 over X plus 1 over, this has to be 17, this is all in millimeters, equals 1 over F. All right, so we can see X is a number. Basically, these two make a larger number. So when you invert it, you get a smaller number, smaller than 17. Right. So if I said, you know, this is 1 over 100, and we said that, okay, invert that 0.1, 1 over 17, and 0.1, invert it back, it's going to go down. So the formula also indicates that to get this to work, F has to go down. All right. So that's how your eye works. That's really it. You're walking on your relaxed eye, focal length of F. Or F equals 17 millimeters, you look at something close and your eye tightens up to bring the image here. Okay, so the only thing that's fixed in your eye is that the S prime, the image distance has to be 17 millimeters or whatever it is for your face. What do we see? Why do we see double when we look at our nose? Oh, that's beyond physics approximations. When you got two eyes, seeing from different angles, we're not even getting into that. Then you got to get into like real biology. And then even if you think you've worked out all the physics with the ray tracing and the thing and the love and the heat, then you're still screwed because then there's how your brain processes it, which isn't even reality either. So that's why we're not even going to bother. What we're going to talk about is how optometrists, total scam. I don't know how much you're paying your optometrist. They work at a booth in the mall. Nothing wrong with that. I love optometrists. They also do other important things like detect cancer, but we're going to make fun of them a little bit here. All right, so let's define something called the near point. All right. Because basically, ultimately, your eye can't do this. You can't pull it off. So it's basically the closest an object can be and remain in focus. Closest an object can be to your face, you know, to your eye, and remain in focus. How close can it be? Now you might say, why can't it go to zero? I mean, here is the thing. Well, for one reason, if F is about 17 millimeters, if you go inside of that, then you're going to have a virtual image. You're not going to have a real image anymore. So you say, okay, well, can't you get all the way to here? And the answer is no, because you'd have to reduce the focal length down to like nothing. And your eye can't do that. So even if you're like a young, perfect human person, it's not zero. You can't get it down to zero. Okay. So let's look at some values. Also, let me add another sentence here. The shortest you can make F, your eye can make F. I didn't think that sentence out ahead of time. Later you can say, does this make sense? Like I was just saying, your eye can only get the F so small. Okay, so let's look at it for a few people. So a young person, this would be the near point, NP. Anybody want to guess? 10 centimeters. So try it yourself. Hold your hand and see when can you see it at 10 centimeters? Is it blurry? It sure is for me. Okay, a normal person. This is like a baby here, or like somebody with incredible vision or something like that. Normally you shoot for, if it's 25 centimeters, good enough. You don't really need to look at something closer than 25 centimeters. I mean, whatever. You don't need to be in focus. And then if you're greater than 40 years old, run into problems. We're at the near point increases. And why does it increase? Due to stiffness in the lens. All right, the lens gets old, gets stiff, and the muscles can't contract it anymore as well. So they can't contract it all the way down to being able to see, to bring it into focus. I mean, they come close, right? So so what happens then to someone who can't contract anymore? Well, we worked on it before. We have a lens here, we have a retina here. If you can't contract enough, then the image is behind the retina, right? So greater than 40 years old, NP, the near point increases due to the stiffness of the lens. So therefore, you can't get it like that. So so this is called presbyopia. Do we have any Presbyterians here? Yes, I was raised Presbyterian. And Presbyterian means the old people are in charge of the church, right? Presbyterian. This means old eyes, right? When you get old, your lens gets stiff, your F can only come down so far. And so only at a certain closeness can you bring this thing onto your retina. What if you're younger with an eyesight of a 70-year-old? That also happens. Perfect segue. Perfect segue. Another thing that causes this is hyperopia. So that is not the case where your lens is stiff. It's the case, and I don't want to shame anyone, but your eyeball is short, okay? And there's your eyeball. A little shorter than it was, you know, the lens was designed for 17 millimeters. Uh-oh, I shamed someone and it shut off my audio. Can y'all hear me? Wow, they're really policing us carefully here.
We can hear
my
you.
Speaker. Oh, my earbud just went out. Wow, as soon as I made fun of someone's eye, I thought they shut me off. And I'm back. Nope. You can hear. Okay, I'll just keep talking then. I'll assume you can hear me. Okay, so hyperopia, short eyeball is what that means. And therefore, the lens is designed to bring it to, you know, where the retina should have been here. Yours is a little short. I've exaggerated here. It's much nicer than that, you know, a millimeter off. And then you need a similar correction to what people need for presbyopia. You need because of hyperopia. Right. So what's presbyopia again? Presbyopia is like when the lens is too stiff. That's what old people get. Presby means old people. Hyperopia you're born with. Your eye is too short. All right. Short eyeball. Okay, so now we're going to design glasses. As long as you can hear. Okay, I can see that you can hear. Okay, so now we're going to design glasses for either presbyopia or hyperopia. And we're going to see what goes on. All right. So design glasses for presby hyper, either one, with a near point of 150 centimeters. And so when you go to the eye doctor, what are they going to do? They're going to measure your near point. Right, they're seeing the thing in here, and can you see that, and can you see that, and can you see that, and eventually, oh wow, my vision, oh no, I have these on. So, no, I mean, I can see it, but I can't focus. Can I focus well? Somewhere out there, and it's already getting blurry here, right? And it's blurrier and blurrier. Now, they have more advanced ways, but basically they're measuring your near point. How close can something get, and you can still see it. It's really all you need to know. Okay, so, how do we do this? Yeah, so, okay, so the near point. So the near point corresponds to their shortest F. I'm gonna write FI, because now we're gonna have a lens in there. It's like the best they can do. So let's draw that out. It would look like this. Here's their lens, here's their retina, and here is where the object has to be. And let's do it all in millimeters. S is 1500 millimeters. right? That's the best they can do. And this has to be 17 millimeters. It's the only choice. So you can figure out what FI can they get down to. 1 over 1500 plus 1 over 17 equals 1 over FI. And that's the shortest they can get. All right, can't beat that. So what we gotta do is put another lens right in front of that lens, okay? And then we also have to have sort of a target. What do we need? We need 25 centimeters. Yes, we need 25 centimeters. So we would say 2F glasses FI, and then your 17 millimeters here is your S prime. And we want to get it, you know, we're not trying to create like, you know, Superman here. So 25 millimeters is enough. So there's your object, and there's 250 millimeters like that. Okay. So what we got to know now is how do you deal with two lenses right next to each other? Okay, so I could go on forever about how to do compound lens systems, and usually we do a little bit of that. But this year I'm just going to tell you that for two very close lenses, like eyeglasses on an eyeball, it's close enough, then 1 over F total, well, 1 over F of the combination, TOT, is 1 over F of the glasses plus 1 over F of the eye. You just add them like that. Okay, we won't get into why. It makes the focus stronger. That's our equation. Okay, so now what do we need to know? If you go to the optometrist, what are you trying to do? You're trying to find out what's my prescription for my glasses. So you're trying to get this number. That's what you want, FG. All right. So what do we know? We know you can only see things down to 1500 millimeters. We want to get that down to 250. What FG do we need? And that's it. So let's look. Let's erase just this, and I'll keep going right here. And we'll say, I didn't solve for this. This FI here was 16.8 millimeters. Right? So that's the best you can do. We can't get it shorter than that. Far away at 17, we can focus it down to about 16.8. And you can't see close things because you can't focus it down smaller than that. All right. Is the 250 millimeter distance from the object to the glasses or the object to the eyes? We're treating it as one object. So it's a thin object. So we call those the same thing. Compared to 250, that distance is small. These are all approximations. All right, so now what we would say is we want this to work. So let's write the equation for this. 1 over 250 is object, plus the image distance has to be 1 over 17. Those two have to be true. And now we need 1 over this whole F, but it's just that plus that. So we could say 1 over F glasses plus 1 over FI. We just substitute a little rule right into the thin lens equation. See that? Oh. And then we could say, okay, we could plug this number into here, right? Because when you're focusing as hard as you can, you're at 16.8. We want to bring that, instead of seeing something at 1500 millimeters, we want to bring it down to 250 millimeters. But it's actually algebraically easier just to put this in, right? Because what's going to happen is then the 1/17 is just going to cancel. Oops, I didn't need to erase on that. So we could instead say 1 over 250 plus 1 over 17, that's like the object image we want to set up, is 1 over the glasses plus 1 over FI was 1 over 1500 plus 1 over 17, right? So this is FI. And the reason you do that is the 17 is actually irrelevant, right? Cancels out in these approximations. It goes away. So then you find that the 1 over F for the glasses that you need, all you really need is the near point. You say, oh, it's 1 over 250. Here's what I want, minus 1 over 1500, the near point I just measured. And that's it. That's all the optometrist is doing, okay? So one measurement of your near point, boom, here's your glasses prescription. Let me bill your insurance $300, okay? They do more. They put the little dye in. They look at your retina. Obviously, I'm just joking. They do more. But physics, this is all they do. Okay. So so all it really is just measuring your point. And then you know the power of the lens that you need. All right. So, well, you see, you need two things. You need to know your near point and how close do you want it to be. So now you actually know. If you wanted to go be able to see really close, you would know what power you need, and you could go buy those at the drugstore. But let's talk about one thing real quick. Optometrists, just to be more obnoxious, are bad at math, okay? So they're not good at fractions, okay? So they don't actually write it like this. They do things in terms of optical power or refractive power, something that's called optical power. Right, because all these one over, why do we want to deal with all this one over? We don't want to deal with that. So power, refractive power is 1/F, okay? It has nothing to do with energy or watts, energy per time. There's no energy. It's just the word they use, power. And the reason is, like, the smaller the F, the harder you're focusing the light. The shorter the focal length, the harder the focus. So if you invert that, you get a big number for something that focuses really hard. And it makes all these equations not be so so annoying. It's in a unit called, diopters. POSF is in diopters, which the abbreviation is D, big D, uppercase D. All right, so then it's even easier than this. All you gotta do is say, what is my power of my glasses? Well, this is a standard of the world, 250. If we express that in meters, that's 0.25. If we invert it, it's 4. So the power of your glasses is 4 diopters minus 1/your near point in meters, right? So that one is 1.5 meters, 1/that is 0.667, yeah, 0.667 diopters, right? And then you say, oh, you need 3.33 diopters. That'll be $300. That's all it is, okay? So you may see things written as these 1/F values. That's questions about the eye. 250 just says your eye. Is your eye power? What is this? The 1/F. Yeah. So power is just 1/F. That's just, that's the lingo they use in the field. So now you're in the know. So next time you're at the optometrist, say, hey, I know all about diopters. Okay, yeah. So to design glasses for, let's see, is this called nearsighted or farsighted? This is farsighted. Because you only see things far. I get those mixed up. I just call it hyperopia and presbyopia. Let's look at the opposite condition. Some of you may, what's the significance of the 250? So 250 is what the medical community has decided is as close as you need to be able to focus on something. It's arbitrary. So you, depending on what you do, maybe you need it closer. But yeah, 250 is just a standard value everybody uses. So there you go. We had a near point. It was too far away, and we used a lens to bring it closer. End of story. And think, what kind of lens did it take? It took a diverging lens. But now let's look at something else. Let's look at myopia. Okay, the farthest you can focus. So somebody with myopia would try to look at those mountains and they can't see them because they're too far away. So this is the one that's more critical for driving, right? If you just can't see something right here, it doesn't affect your driving. If you can't see something down the road, like a sign or brake lights, then this is the one. Glasses required on your driver's license. So the farthest you can focus is 200 centimeters, let's say. This is just an example. Or let's define it. Focus is the far point. I'm gonna call that FP, is the far point. All right. So you can't see those mountains. Everything's blurry until you get, say, 200 centimeters. That's pretty, 200 meters. That's pretty bad. Yeah. Such as 200 centimeters, say. Say that's your far point. All right. So let's see. So your eye is going to do this. I didn't review this. Let's see. 200 centimeters, we got this, we got your thing back here. That has to be 1.7, that's 200, that's all fine. And we'd say, okay, what is F of the I in this case, 1 over 200 plus 1 over 1.7 equals 1 over fi. Again, that's the best it can do. So we're going to use that in a minute. Okay? It can do that. It just can't do more. But you want, so you have, and now you want to be able to see something at infinity. So you want, oh, the mountain is infinitely far away. So we're going to need this. And oh, I guess I didn't say so. The problem is, the opposite problem is that the image is ending up here. It's not that you can't focus it tighter. It's that it's too tight and you can't loosen the eye enough. So this isn't really something with old age and a stiff lens. I guess if lenses got floppy, then this would come with old age. But this is really, yeah, this is like a long eye. Right? If the eye is too long, then the optics are designed for 1.7, but your spacing is actually bigger. We still wrote 1.7 just to have a number, but you get the idea. So maybe this is like 2, and the lens is designed for 1.7, or maybe this is 2. Anyway, that's the idea. So how do we fix this? So let's see, we have the case that the image is going here. We want it out here. We need it to go back. We need to focus less hard. We need the effective focal length of this to get longer, so we have to put a diverging lens in front of your eye. Ah, yes. So here we have f of the eye, and here we have f of the glasses. And you can just tell by the way you need to be able to move the image that you need to diverge the light more. So that's why you need a diverging lens. So if we want to be able to see infinity, we want to be infinitely far away, we want to land it on the retina, and that's got to be equal to combining these. All right. So when we solve this, we'd say, okay, well, what is the best the eye can do? It's 1 over 200 plus 1 over 1.7. So I'm just kind of, we're just doing this one quickly. The other one is the more instructive. But it looks exactly like what we did before. You know, we're just going through and saying, okay, 1 over 1.7. Doesn't really matter. It's not really so much this exact distance that you need to know. It's what's your far point? What's the farthest you can see? That's all you really need to know to figure out how to fix it. So then you say, well, what's 1 over infinity? Well, that's 0. So you find that what you need is equal to minus 1 over your far point. I'm doing this in centimeters, not millimeters now, sorry. That's it. Even easier for the optometrist. They don't even have to subtract anything. They say, what's your far point? Okay, let me invert, put that in meters and invert it. That's the diopters of your lens. That's it. So in this case, it's 2 meters. So FG equals minus 2 meters, or the diopters of the glasses you need is minus 0.5. I'm sorry, that's a power. The power of the glasses is minus 0.5 diopters in this case. That's all they're doing. And then you can see things infinitely far away, and you can see the cars coming and everything. What if your power is minus 7? If your glasses power is minus 7, that, let's see, is that stronger or weaker than this? Let's see, if it's minus 7, if you flip that over, 1 over, you know, 1 over 0.5 is 2, 1 over 7 is like point something, so it's a shorter focal length. Yes, those are stronger. Yeah. Okay, so then how is this useful in your life? It could be useful, actually, if you, you know, if you go to the store, like if you lose your glasses and you just have to go buy some, like at the drugstore just to get by, now you know what the big D means. Those are your diopters. That's the power of the lenses. And, you know, then there's bifocals or transitions. Like these are transitions, like when I look down at magnifier, so I can see things and I look up and it's actually a little bit of correction for something else. I forgot what. But the most interesting thing about all this to me when I learned this is I realized you can tell if people are nearsighted or farsighted by looking at their face behind their glasses. Okay. So if their face looks magnified, I mean, most glasses you can't tell. It's like such a teeny correction you don't even notice. But if you can tell that their eyes look a little bit magnified, then it's presbyopia, hyperopia. But if it looks demagnified, it's because the lenses are negative and it's myopia. So you can actually just tell about looking at people. Not that you should be judging people's vision as you walk around, but it's just interesting in terms of the physics. This is what I do all day. All right. So that's actually all. So I keep saying this over and over. That's all we're going to do for that topic. Usually we do more, right? I mean, really, the main topics we've cut much in the whole year are a teeny bit of circuits and this. And starting next week on magnetism, we're going to be back to our normal level of material. And I will get these problems out, these homeworks out soon with some super extended deadline. I have to cut half of them. All right. Exam tomorrow night. Take it when you want. Don't wait till the last minute. I don't want a big rush of, could I have one more day? We don't want to do that. So I would get it over with. All right, good luck. How hard is the exam, in my opinion? It's like the last exam. I would say it's about the same as the last exam. I mean, I find it extremely easy, but relatively, it's like the last exam.